Welcome to this lecture in 2DV604 software architecture. This is a lecture in theme one, and now we're gonna talk a little somewhat about one of the most important strategies you use as a software architecture, how you manage complexity, size and scale in your projects, and that is decomposition. So in this lecture, we will try to answer the question what decomposition is. I'm afraid that it's much more than what we're able to cover in this short lecture, but I hope that you will get some idea because it's a general mechanism that you can apply in many different settings on many different problems and for many different purposes. So I hope that this will give you some insights, but I can promise you one thing, and that is that we will not be able to cover it all. So one of the more well-known properties of software is these characteristics. They were originally introduced by Fred Brooks in his seminal book, The Mythical Man-Month, where he describes the inherent complexity as one of the main difficulties. That is that, well, software is complex. You cannot get away from component interactions, dependencies, and also the fact that software is a state machine, one huge state machine, and you don't have to add much code to get an exponential growth in that state machine. So the inherent complexity is the top challenge for any software developer. Second is changeability. The fact that, well, software is often a model of the real world, and, well, real world changes. And as a consequence, our software systems also change. We have to add more functionality. We have to see to that the software runs on new hardware, etc. And this changeability creates many problems because you have to think about change at all, well, throughout the development, and that's a huge problem. Third is conformity. The fact that we're talking about system architectures and software architectures, well, the software systems we develop, they are parts of larger system architectures, and it means that the software must conform to interfaces defined by the surrounding systems. The fourth characteristic is probably something that you haven't spent too much time thinking about, but you can't see software. Software is invisible in the sense that we are only working on representations of the software. Source code is not software, it's a representation of the software. Compare this to engineers that construct a bridge. They see the bridge grow, they can see if there are any problems lurking, same with houses, same with cars, etc. But for software, we work on models, and we have to be able to see problems in our models, because the real software is very difficult to observe. So how do we manage this? How do we manage complexity, for instance? How do we deal with invisibility? Well, complexity is a big challenge. The system grows every year, all the time. Customers ask for more functionality, more features, support for new systems, etc. And over the years, people have developed many techniques for dealing with this complexity. And two of the best techniques, or most widely used techniques, are abstraction and decomposition. And abstraction is about focusing on what's relevant in a given context. You know that software is modeling the real world, which means that we have to create models of these entities, the real world entities. And if we use abstraction, we make simplifications where we focus on what's relevant in a particular context. So not all information is relevant in all contexts, and for that we use data abstraction, we use functional abstractions, and by that, well, we reduce the size of the problems. The second technique is decomposition, and this is the main strategy for software architects. One characteristic of a complex problem was highlighted by the Nobel laureate Herb Simon in his paper on architecture of complexity. And that is the fact that complex systems, one of the characteristics is the fact that it's composed of subsystems, that you can always identify parts of a system that where the communication between elements in that part is more intense than communication to other parts of the system. And this is something that is used to identify subsystems. It means that you can take a system or you can take a problem and divide it into two parts. And then you can deal with the parts separate from each other. And that is a powerful mechanism to reduce complexity. This is known as divide and conquer, and it was, or algorithmic decomposition, as Dijkstra introduced it in the early 70s. And divide and conquer, it means that we take a problem and we can divide it up into subproblems that can be further divided, and we can continue to do that until we reach a level where we can actually map something directly to a programming construct, and then we merge or we put these parts together all the way up until we have a complete solution at the top on the right hand side here on the slide. So decomposition, you split the problem up, then you solve the smallest parts, and then you put the parts together all the way up to the top. The second characteristic that developers face is the invisibility. And here, models are key, because models are the representation we use to work with our software systems. And models are important because if you have well-defined models, they establish a language. For instance, if you think about a UML class diagram, if all software engineers in the team understand UML class diagrams, well, you don't have to explain what the notation describes. You establish a graphical language with a vocabulary and with crisp and clear semantics. Everybody in the team understands the meaning of a extends relationship or some other type of dependency. So models provide an ideal framework that we can use to develop models of systems or processes, it means that we cannot cover all aspects. Idealized means that we have some abstractions, we have decomposition in the models, and both are to some extent simplifications. And simplifications means that, well, some details have been removed, and some details may actually impact the system. So models are not exact representations of a system, and that's why we have to combine several models to describe a system completely. So there are some properties, because models reduce complexity and to some extent also remove uncertainty about a system. With these models, we can deal with more information than we can comprehend. And that's an important aspect, that we can take one model and we can focus on one or a few aspects of the system. And then when we have to think of something or look at something different, well, we bring out a different model and we focus on that. If we had combined the two into one model, it might have been the case that it would have been too complex, too much information, and very difficult for a human being to comprehend. So again, we have abstraction, we reduce information, we use modularity to identify the crisp boundaries for these abstractions, the interfaces, and we use these modular abstractions to form hierarchies. So we can take one abstraction, one module, and split it up into several inner abstractions, inner modules, and form hierarchies. That's the way we structure our models. These three provide for the fourth, the fact that we can, with this approach, hide information. Software engineers, developers, programmers are not necessarily interested in how certain features, certain methods in an API are realized. They are interested in how to use them. So if you can encapsulate the details of how, you reduce the information an engineer is required to understand, are required to grasp, and they can focus on the usage, and that's a very important property. So coming back to abstractions, we do that because it's so important. It's a simplified description, specification of a system that emphasizes some details while suppressing others. So coming back to this context, that we focus on certain details that are relevant in this specific context. This means that the same abstraction may exist several times in the same system. It's just that the focus is different and we have a different abstraction for the same entity. Modularity is about grouping, grouping abstractions to form modules. And this can be done using several different heuristics. One of the most well-known is object that we use when we work with object-oriented analysis and design, where we actually group data and operations on that data into objects, and we specify these objects with classes. But as you see, there are many other ways to create modules. Goals is also one way of structuring. However, that is fairly complex heuristic, but we will use this in the software architecture course, but then you will see that we will have to use many different types of structures and combine it with behavior in order to fully cover how certain goals are satisfied or reached in a system. Hierarchy, well, we compose subsystems into larger systems, important for divide and conquer, essential for understanding complex systems. This characteristic is supported in programming languages. We have object hierarchies, we have class hierarchies, we have file hierarchies, etc. The fourth, encapsulation, the fact that we provide a contract, an interface to the abstractions that hides the implementation is a strong complexity reducing mechanism that is supported in some programming languages, but you also see it in modeling. When you model classes, you provide descriptions of the methods, you have public attributes, etc. And that shows users of that abstraction how to use it, but it doesn't tell the users of that abstraction too much about the implementation. It doesn't give away the implementation, which means in principle that, and this addresses changeability, that you can actually change the innards of a class, of an object of that class. So you can change the implementation without that change affecting any user of that abstraction, as long as you don't change the interface, as long as you preserve the encapsulation. So just to illustrate decomposition, and at this point we come back to the system that we used in the introduction, where we have Peter, Paul and Mary developing this file sharing application. And what is in focus here, and for whom are you decomposing, which model notation you should use? Well, this depends on exactly the context. So what is in focus? Is it the functionality? Is it security? Is it how files are shared? Is it performance? Well, that controls how you decompose and also the models, the type of model notation you can use. The second important aspect is, of course, for whom you're decomposing. We saw that in the introduction slide, that functionality, we can provide three different decompositions, one for Paul, one for Peter and Mary, and one for the customer, using different notations for them. So say that we are dividing this up into subsystems using, we identify abstractions, we group abstractions into modules, we present interfaces, etc. But still, this is a boxes and lines notation that we have to explain for each and every one. So it's not a real modeling notation because the vocabulary and the semantics is not clear. So instead, we should go to some more established notation. And for that, well, we have to figure out, well, we're dealing with functionality in this case. Paul is interested that he was the manager, and we decide to use an UML component model. Well, using that, well, we change our boxes, we change the interfaces into UML component notation. And here you see that we have users, we have documents, reports, sharing as separate components. In this picture, for the purpose of communication, I don't add interfaces here, but as you all know, you have to decide what interfaces does the sharing component provide to the others, and will it or does it require any services from any other component in the system? Moving on, well, we can come up with a second decomposition, and now you see that we use UML use case diagrams, and the purpose here is, well, focus, functionality, so that is the same. However, here's the customer. So for the customer, component models might be challenging to grasp, and it's also maybe on a too detailed level. That is that we use an abstraction level, which is too low for that stakeholder. So instead, we take it up to a level where we talk about key functionality in the system, and user groups or stakeholders, and for that, well, the UML use case model is really suitable. So decomposition, well, we manage complexity, and there are some certain parts of it. We have abstractions, we have modularity, we have the hierarchy, and we have the encapsulation that are all contributing to forming good decompositions of complex systems. But remember that you have to figure out what is the purpose of this decomposition. What are the concerns or the concerns that you're addressing with this decomposition? Who is the decomposition for? Is it an internal developers that are knowledgeable in the system? They have to understand lots of details, etc. That controls to a large extent which language or notation you use, because the vocabulary, the semantics, well, simple vocabulary, simple semantics for groups that are not that knowledgeable in software development, and then you have a more complex notation, vocabulary, become more complex semantics for describing system details. So keep these steps in mind when you perform your decompositions. There's also another important aspect, and decomposition could actually add to the complexity. This means that you have to balance the cost, the benefit, and the risk by decomposing. Because adding, for instance, as in this example, more interfaces. Here we have on the left-hand side six dependencies inside a module. And then we decide to split this module into two. So we add an interface where we have create a module with two abstractions on the left-hand side, and then a common interface, and then a module with three modules on the right-hand side. However, what you will see here is that this actually creates nine dependencies, and nine is more than six, which means that this could be more difficult, challenging to manage over time. But on the right hand side, you see the outside view of the decomposition of one module into two. So adding this interface that grew the dependencies to nine, well, one step up, it's just one dependency. So we go from six to one, and that could actually fool developers that okay, this looks more simple, so then it's better. But beware that it could be the other way around. So carefully evaluate cost benefit and the risk of decomposition, and manage that trade-off carefully. Okay, so by that we come to the end of this short introduction to the important strategy for software architecture decomposition. So I hope to see you soon. Bye for now.